Welcome, everyone. This is Coaching in Session. My name is Michael Reardon, and I will be your Mindset Coach today. And today, we're going to be talking about masculinity. Now, if you know anything about me, I am pro-masculinity. I'm pro-men being the monsters that they're supposed to be. However, today, we live in a world where masculinity is toxic, and if you are a masculine man, you are attacked, you are ridiculed, and you are canceled. So we do have to understand that men are being attacked because they're showing their true power, their true nature. And that nature is not appropriate to our world today. Men should be weak. Men should be docile. And if men choose to be strong, we will attack them. We will belittle them. We will say that this is not appropriate. And I mean, I have so many stories, even just growing up, like when I was first doing accounting and things like that, my coordinator for the whole Sikorsky thing. She was a woman, black woman, boss babe, mother bear, feminist. So when I had a conversation with one of my mentors, a mentor happened to be a woman, and she couldn't handle me, right? Too much masculine energy, too much masculine nature. So I got in trouble, right? Oh, you can't do that here. It's too masculine, basically, is what the conversation was. So masculinity was shunned upon. And I had to learn, like, I can't even be my true nature here because people are going to be hurt. And the conversation that I'm going to be bringing you today is not just with myself. It's going to be with my guest, Andrew Cope, who is a masculinity coach. And we actually talk about this aspect on how masculinity is not something that is promoted. It is demoted when it comes to men. But when it comes to women, you're a boss babe. You are a go girl. Our world today is so different than the world in the past, and we do have to understand that just because the world doesn't want us to be masculine, it doesn't mean that we should choose feminine. So let's learn how to be masculine with Andrew Cope and myself. Welcome, Andrew Cope, to Coaching in Session. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good, Michael. How are you?
Doing well. Thanks so much for coming on. Today, we're going to be having you on as a masculinity coach, and if you don't have a job that is abundant, oh my goodness, like, our world needs more men like you today helping other men step into their power, right? Women love to say, oh, step into your power, become empowered, but men have lost their power. They have given it away. Just before you and I got on, we were talking about freedom and how we are free and we should always remain free, and men should always remain in that masculine role. So we're going to be talking about the work that you do, how you help men be more masculine, in the sense, because we are living in a world where men can be feminized at a sitcom, at a podcast or whatever, because masculinity today is considered toxic. And we're going to get into all that. Without me talking about your whole biography, can you tell the world who you are, what you do, and how you help?
My name is Andrew Cope. I'm a masculinity coach. And essentially what I do, and you touched on it, is I help men to basically take their power back, right? Really, from the time we're born until, you know, we pass on to the next phase of life, men recently, at least by in the last like 20 or 30 years, kind of been crapped on, right? So we're exposed to weakness in the space, like you said, music and sitcoms and movies. There's always the, you know, weak or perceived dumb father figure, the one that is basically miscalculated, right? One that is pushed off, one that is essentially demeaned. And we've kind of been taught, like you said, and, you know, something that I believe in, we've been taught from a young age to dim our light, to essentially step back from a leadership role and a leadership position in masculinity, and to kind of let life run its way by us, right? We're not taught to take control. We're not taught to occupy space, right? We're not taught to stand our ground and to make boundaries and to communicate properly. And so in reality, something that I've been blessed with by the universe kind of from a very young age, based off of how I was brought up, was that we kind of need to own what we are and what that is. And so I help men basically, first things first, self-reflect and to really understand how they've been portraying themselves and how they've been coming off in their world. And then to help identify ways that they can change their perceptions of themselves, and then based off of how they interact with people, how people perceive them.
Yeah. The question I do want to ask, because all of what you said is true and it is happening in our world today, why are we not being taught to be leaders? Why are we not being taught to be true to our nature? Why are we taught to be docile and obedient rather than like the hunters and the trailblazers that we're supposed to be?
I think it's because we're easier to control in that way, right? Testosterone, masculinity. What we're designed to do biologically is, like you said, we're hunters. We take care of the tribe. We take care of our people. We take care of our women. I think in a world where you have values that are concrete and you have a foundation that is set, it becomes a lot more difficult for, you know, the powers that be to influence you to do nothing and to sit by. Because in the way that society works today with capitalism, somebody has to lose. It makes it a lot easier to lose as a man if you aren't in touch with your beast, with that spirit, with your masculine power.
Well, masculinity is only toxic if you're a man. But if you have a masculine nature, if you're a woman, you're a boss babe, you're a CEO, you are going to have those masculine traits, but it's considered a good thing, right? You're a boss babe, you go right. Girl. Why is it like that for women, but not for men? Because masculinity should be just one concept, but why is it different between the sexes?
So I think historically, and this is society in general, this isn't just specifically with women, but I think historically we overcorrect, right? So when we are in a situation where some part of society, some people have been mistreated over time, we acknowledge and then we overcorrect, right? And I think that what ends up happening with the overcorrection is the discourse that is very paramount to coming to that even common ground kind of gets lost in translation, right? So we can say, yes, people of color have been mistreated. So we need to change things and change ideas and have those conversations around how we can equal that balance, right? It's the same thing with women. It's the same thing with people who identify, whether it's their gender, you know what I mean, religion. Basically, all throughout society, there have been people that have gotten the short end of the stick. Because of the way that we like to feel good about ourselves, we overcorrect, right? So in this case, there's been a lack of trust between men and women as a result of the things that we've been able to be exposed to, right? So the feminist movement, the Me Too movement, which needed to happen, right? Because people do need to be knocked off of their perceived pedestals, especially when they're treating people improperly. But what happens when that trust isn't there? Women take a more masculine role. So because of all the things that men have been subjected to that have made us docile, that have dimmed our lights, that have weakened us, women take on that role. In doing that, taking on that role with social media and how connected the world is today in the internet, it's, you know, we celebrate those things, right? Because of in the history, you know, women stay in the kitchen, you know, don't have a career, don't have a job, which I believe is kind of up to everybody's individual perspective and what they want to do. But I also believe in having that boundary between how I perceive life and how I want to live it, and then how I could have a partner in that way. So I think the overcorrection of the mistakes that have been made in the past by men have led to the situation that we're in today, where it's hard for guys to have power in the decisions that they make and how they show up.
But we do have to get into the mindset, though, of what is masculine men, because I understand the feminist movement, why they did it. It was something that was appropriate at the time, but it just turned into, it went over the equality aspect. It's like, all right, now we're going to be superior. And I mean, if you watch a movie, I mean, you see like guys getting thrown 50 feet and then girls like are just standing there like nothing happened, or like they'll throw a guy, you know, 100 feet. And it's just like, where is the concept of reality? And in their mind, that is what we're feeding them. It's just like, we're strong, we're powerful. And you are strong, you are powerful, you do have a superpower. But many women are stepping into masculine superpowers rather than feminine superpowers. And what men are doing today, they're stepping into feminine superpowers, the trans movement, you know, look at the Dylan guy and stuff like that, 8 million followers or something on TikTok or whatever his platform is. Why is that happening? Is that happening because of the roles switching, or because of the gender ideology switching, that women should be masculine and men should be feminine?
So I think a little bit of both, right? How I believe society works is they're trying to separate people, right? And so, you know, break up the family unit, break up everybody's appreciation for a higher power, religion, right? Common sense is kind of out the window. And then also too, just understanding historically what are we designed to do? So, you know, one of the things that I think ends up being like that little bit of a gray area there is people don't realize what's actually happening. You don't really know how indoctrinated you are to, as a man, be weak. Like we've said, you see it all over the place. So I think the gender role changing is, it has a lot to do with wanting to feel good about yourself, which everybody does, right? because we've been conditioned to a woman that stays at home and is a stay-at-home mom. She's, you know, she's not deemed as valuable to society, right? I don't necessarily agree with that, but I also, the last girl that I dated was a very successful businesswoman. That was awesome to see her in her power to do those things, right? But I think because we have a bad definition of what masculinity is, we're not able to actually discern what should work and what shouldn't work for men and women in society. So with no defined role, right? No defined definition, you can kind of make it whatever you want. And in that case, with the world today, because it's so easy for everyone really to do everything, and that's be lazy, that's also be successful. We perceive as society with success and power as a fiscal game, right? So we listen to people who are successful, you know, with money and in business about everything, which I don't think that is actually the best way to do it, right? Because I'm not going to ask my dentist about how I should take care of my skin, right? I'm not going to ask a woman about how I should be a masculine man. But because of attention and eyes and influence and followings, you have a lot of people that are trying to fill the roles and fill the shoes of something that they really have no business doing, which it's okay, but it doesn't work for me. And that's why I'm here doing what I do.
Yes. And it's something I see in a lot of coaches sometimes. Sometimes I'll see like a woman coach and she helps men find relationships. And I'm like, how does that work? I've seen it work to some degree, but typically the guys are more feminine natured. And it's easier to say, well, I'm going to find you a masculine chick. And you know, you can find those a dime a dozen. It's easier to do that. But then when you have someone who's a masculine trait trying to work with that woman who's trying to be that male coach, that guy is going to be working with her for about 2-3 years and he's not going to have any results. And I actually had a guest early on when I started the podcast. She had a guy for about almost 3 years, poor guy, 3 years and no love, no relationship. Ugh. It takes me like 2-3 months to find a guy or a girl, a relationship. I'm talking about marriage and kids. It is that simple. It's because I understand the roles. I understand what you want. And you just have to tell me a couple of things. And I know, all right, this is probably your mindset. This is what you want in the future. I just, you know, ask the questions. I make sure this is truly what you want. And then that's what we go for versus like, you know what? I think you need this instead. It's just like, you don't know what I'm thinking. And I don't know what any of my clients are thinking. That's why I have to ask questions. But I have found that women, and I'm not putting women out there or anything, but they operate in their emotions. Like, I feel that I think you should be doing this instead of that. That's dangerous because everyone is different, right? And I think men are just better at it than women saying, okay, hey, I see where you're coming from. We can make this work. And I think we do need to define, well, what is a good definition of masculinity? Because if we don't have that clear definition, then how do we have some direction or the direction in understanding who we have to become? So what is your definition or good definition of masculinity today?
Yeah. So to me, being masculine is really being able to take care of business, right? Being dangerous without being a danger. So it's one of those things where to me, to be a masculine male, you need to be able to step up in uncomfortable situations. You need to be able to take care of the things that you care about, the people around you. You need to be strong, and you need to be not only strong physically, but you need to be strong in your ideals, strong with your boundaries, strong how you communicate. Also being emotionally aware. And I think that's what you just addressed about how we have this. We have effeminate male coaches. We have masculine female coaches, right? What we're forgetting in that is to remain grounded throughout that process, right? So yes, it's great to, we all have masculine and feminine energy, right? That's just a part of who we are. Men, we operate logistically, right? We operate in a way that makes sense to us. What is quantifiable, right? We're less emotionally based. We're more action with logic, right? So for me to be an embodied masculine male, because I like to say that, is strong, willing to sacrifice, but not sacrificing your ideal and your moral to be the type of person that you need to be. So communicate well, respect women specifically for sure. Yes. But also understanding that saying no is one of the most powerful things you can be as a man in a masculine way, but really figuring out the things that you care about. What are the things that fuel your fire? And I think a lot of times in the coaching space specifically is we are conditioned or we take on the ideals of the people that we emulate, but we don't really ever make the connection of like, is this person that is influencing me in this way someone that I'd like to end up being like? Do they look like I want to look like? Do they live the life that I'd like to live? I think because of the whole popularity thing that we were kind of talking about before, that people end up not asking themselves those questions. And that's the first thing that I do with everybody that I work with. You've got to figure out what is important to you, right? What are the things that get you out of bed every day? What are the reasons that you do A, B, and C, right? And then can we come together and build a good foundation for the rest of your life?
Yeah, and that's important, right? I think it was like in third grade or something like that. My dad said, handle your business or take care of business. And that was like when I understood what a man was, like take care of your business, no matter what it was. If you don't feel like doing it, oh, well, do it, right? Like most of these guys who work 9 to 5s, you know, like they do it for their family. But then even that can be a detriment to themselves because they might be in a job that they're not happy with. So they have to do some type of pivot, but yet they're just doing it because they think that that is their role. You can live in abundance. You can have a lot of good things in your life. You do have to know how to do it. Sometimes men have a hard time with that because they find a nice little spot. It's comfortable. Men love to be in that box of nothingness. We go fishing. We go to a guy's trip and literally we do stupid stuff. Girls would probably look at us and be like, what are you guys doing? You're wasting time. And for us, like, you know, we see you watching sitcoms and crying when, like, you know, watching a Notebook. We're like, what are you doing? So it's a different dynamic when it comes to that. And you started off, right? Like now we're getting into the aspect of helping men, starting to learn about their masculinity, define their masculinity, and then to begin the process to attain or retain their masculinity. What is that process? I know you talked about like defining your purpose, your why, and things like that. I know another one that we're probably going to be talking about is like fitness. What is your process to helping men from A to Z, how to get them from where they are today, docile, to that masculine nature man that they should be?
Right. So with me, I think everything starts with the physical, right? So what is your relationship with your body? When you look in a mirror, you know, I talked about this a lot on social media. When you look in a mirror, does what look back, your reflection, does that actually reflect your opinion of yourself, right? And if it's so, starting with the physical, and if it doesn't, what can we do to change? Because I think if you're able to build a good foundation, right? Build a routine and do the things that are difficult, especially when it comes to facing yourself. That's like the segue into everything else that we do. So with every client that I work with, the first thing we always address is your physical body. Are you working out? Are you eating well? Are you getting enough sleep? And then with that comes to commitments and ritual, right? What are the things that you are committed to unwaveringly that you will not sacrifice and you will not miss as a result of whatever comes up in your life, right? What are the things that are non-negotiable for you? Then I usually talk about style and how we come off in the world at large, right? And then communication. Like I said, building those routines and doing the things that are difficult, like with our bodies. Most of us have also been exposed to what the perfect man looks like, right? They're a tall, white dude, you know what I mean? With blue eyes and he's ripped and, you know, he's perfect, right? Jesus is white. Like every, you know what I mean? Every, like, as men, we are told if you don't look like Brad Pitt, if you don't look like George Clooney, if you don't look like Idris Elba, then you're irrelevant, right? And so that really goes into our self-conscious, right? So I think our physical manifestation is a reflection of our subconscious mind. So that's the first thing to start, because it's the easiest thing to have changed in your mind once you see yourself, once you feel something, right? As guys, we're supposed to be rough. We're supposed to play in that way. We're supposed to be hands-on. Or we're supposed to be a little bit dirty here and there, right? And a lot of us lose that the older we get, the more we live life. So for me, it starts with your body. And then we'll turn that into the commitments that you have to yourself, routines and rituals that you get into, right? Morning routines, cold showers, journaling. Then it's into, you know, how you look. Hey, do your clothes fit you? You know what I mean? Are you hiding when you leave your house, right? And then how you communicate with people. Because I think I have a client specifically who had an issue with his ability to start conversations when he was out and about. So I said, hey, what is a way to start a conversation without having to say anything? And boom, that's how you look. That's your presence. That's the energy that you carry into a room. It's a little cheat code that I did for him that I'll, you know, share with our listeners. I was like, hey, you know, get an article of clothing, a statement piece that you wouldn't normally wear, but that's a little bit loud, but not loud in a way that's obnoxious. And then have people talk to you about it. So he, you know, I think he bought a pair of boots or something like that, a nice pair of boots, goes out. And people are just like, damn, those are nice. Wow, where'd you get them? Damn, those are crazy. And so what he ended up doing after coming back and, you know, he and I reflecting, he's like, dude, I had 10 people start a conversation with me. And I didn't even know what to say to initiate those things. But now that I'm understanding that it's my presence, it's how I walk into a room and how I occupy space. So So there's just a lot of little things like that that can go a long way. But, you know, to answer the question, body is number one, right? Because if we don't feel good, we don't look good, we don't look good, we don't play good, we don't play good, they don't pay good. Shout out to Deion Sanders.
Yeah. I wanted to get into the aspect of masculine energy. So, for example, if you walk into a room, people are going to probably notice you, right? You are a big guy, you're in shape. Typically, people notice me. I'm 6'4", I'm a big guy. When I walk into an environment, people notice me first. It's a good thing, right? I want to be noticed. When I walk in, I just set the tone. And before I was a coach, I was actually a teacher. I never really had an issue with behavioral problems. Tall black man who's in shape, strong, right? Huge biceps, you know, like everything is like scary, like to me. When people see me, they're afraid of me. I'm a nice guy. But again, you know, like I have that line in the sand, you don't cross it.
Right.
Most people should have that. We create that energy wherever we walk into. So I can create conversation if I want to, or I can create an aura like, don't mess with me. Don't talk to me. I don't want to be bothered.
Exactly.
And we just have that energy. And I want to get into a conversation with you today that we can explain to people, especially men, how they can step into that energy and then they can be noticed or they can be that fly in the wall that no one really cares about.
Yeah. I think so. A big part of it is how you operate, like how you move your body, right? For me, I'm big on eye contact. Eye contact is massive. Even if you're in a room where you don't know anyone, looking at people is one of the things when you're expolling your energy, your aura. It's your posture, right? If you're walking in a room and you're standing up straight versus being hunched, if you're looking forward versus looking down, right? How you walk. If you look like you're in a rush and you're uneasy, you're probably in a rush and you're uneasy, right? People have a tendency to not trust uneasy energy around them, right? So for me, you know, I'm from the South, right? Born and raised in Kentucky. And where I come from, life's a little bit of a slower pace. And I just have, you know, fortunately for being a masculine male, moving at your own speed is a really big part of it. But I think a lot of people don't realize how their body language and how their posture and how they speak and how they look in people's eyes, it really does play an effect on your ability to get attention or close yourself off from it, right? If you walk in a room and you know exactly where you're going and you get there, people are usually going to be like, oh, okay, that person, you know, maybe I'm not going to talk to him, right? It's the difference between having, you know, the eyebrows down and together versus your eyebrows being relaxed. So there's just a lot of things that people don't understand, the physical social cue that goes a lot into how you occupy space.
Couple of things also is like when you're walking, like you mentioned this, right? You look down. Sometimes when you look down a lot, like your neck begins to like do that naturally. So you just like look down like you're always hunching. People are not going to want to talk to you. However, if you can change your posture, so you could do some like reverse fly, so you can start to bring your shoulders back.
Rear delt stuff.
Yep. And I also recommend wearing a brace for a little bit, especially if you are already hunched down, to bring your body back up and into that posture. And then to pay attention when you're walking, because when you're walking, you shouldn't just be looking down. You should always be looking forward. You can be looking at people. If someone looks at you, make eye contact with them. Don't just go, oh, they looked at me and run away. Be confident. Right. Look at them, right? What are they going to do, right? They might say hi to you. They might, you know, like give you like a dirty look. Who cares? Men know something that is like the unspoken rule of men. It's like typically men are just not going to engage in some type of physical altercation because they understand that the altercation can be very bad for them. So most men are not going to just say, hey, what are you looking at? You know, like typically they're like, this could be a staring contest, but like whatever, like at the end of it, like as soon as you're done with the gaze, it's cool, right? You cannot be afraid of that gaze. And women actually love that gaze. So when you're making eye contact and you're creating that tension, you need that. Even before I got married, like if I walked into a bar, again, I'm tall, I'm a big guy. I can just walk into the bar. I'm confident. I know where I'm going. I would have like girls like look at me and things like that. And one time I went to a bar and this was like with my cousin. He had came into town, into Austin, and we had just like, you know, gone out and things like that. And apparently, like, I was just doing what I'm doing. I know where I'm going. So it was this girl that he was kind of like a couple steps back, like, you know, like kind of surveying the land. And then he heard this girl say, oh, my God, the only thing he has to do is say one word and I'm his. So you can create that energy, guys. And I don't want you to feel like you have to look like me or you have to look like Andrew here. It's all how you walk. It's how you present yourself. Fitness is a big thing. Eye contact is a big thing. Posture is a big thing. But then you also have to understand your energy too, right? What are you bringing out? Are you afraid? Are you confident? And that is where masculinity shines, confidence. And I wanted to get into that confidence aspect of masculinity. What does that look like to you?
So for me, it's how you value yourself, self-worth, right? So if no one can knock me off of my game because I know how I feel about myself, right? I know about the work that I put in. I know about the grind that I've been through. I know about all the experiences that I have as a human being and as a masculine male in today's society. So I think having to work on that first, like that's the biggest part of that, right? Your self-worth. Because a lot of times guys don't understand that you're going to deal with loss. You're going to deal with failure. You're going to deal with rejection. It's how you respond to those things as opposed to reacting to those things that really will set a precedence for you and the people around you, right? I really talk about how all human beings have intuition and it works. The difference between someone who is self-aware and isn't is listening to their intuition or not. So even if, you know, you've got guys that have the facade of, oh, he's got everything figured out and this, that, and the other, but when you're around them, you can just tell that their energy is off. It's because they're not in tune with how they actually feel about themselves. So for me, it's your self-confidence, right? What are you doing to prove to yourself every day that you are worth it, that you are that guy, that you are a person that is worthy of respect, that is worthy of attention, and is worthy of respect in your boundaries and how you feel about things. So yeah, for me, it's confidence, how you feel about yourself. Because if you don't feel good about yourself, then it doesn't matter what I do or what anybody does. That's going to always be the key that's going to bring you into the success or not.
Yeah. And we do have to feel good about ourselves. The saying, you know, you look good, you feel good is something. And then we have an aspect of the inside of who you are, right? That character you create. Sometimes you might give yourself a backstory role where you're just like a B-list character or B-list actor, but you do have to learn how to be the rock star, the celebrity, the lead actor in your life. How do you get there, right? Typically, most men are going to just think that they're always going to be that B-list celebrity, that they'll never amount to anything. And it's just a mindset shift. You just have to switch that and say that I am something, right? I am relevant. And you can get that so many ways. Number one, confidence, mindset, doing martial arts, fighting, healthy competition. All of those are going to help you, even if you don't win in the competition. Let's say you get fifth place or something like that. You still beat, 20 other guys? That right there is going to be a huge boost for you. Like, you don't have to always be number one, but just the aspect of healthy competition, understanding that you are ahead, because you are going to look back at the conversation we had earlier, that you have to look like Brad Pitt or Idris or whatever. You have to look like them in order for you to be successful in getting ladies or, you know, your career.
In life, jobs, exactly. It's not like that.
It's not. You do have to know that you can make some great strides. And the best way to make strides, if you are a man that is struggling with your masculinity and struggling with your nature, is to get a coach, get a mentor like Andrew, who's going to be helping you along the way, looking at you and just saying, okay, well, like, I can see where you're going. Nothing wrong with it. But I think if we go this way, we're going to have so much more success in our career, our ladies, etc. And that is where you shine, right? That is where you help men understand their masculinity, understand that they can be so much more than what they are today. And that was what this conversation was, helping men be men. We are wrapping up, and I do want to get some final words from you before we go. And then I want you to tell the audience where they can find you so they can work with you.
Perfect. Yeah. So I think, you know, everything that we talked about, super valid, there's a point in it. But the hardest thing that we have to do as men is face ourselves. We have to face the things that we've been through. We have to understand the instances and the experiences that we had in our past that actually changed our behavior. Because I don't think it's our responsibility as men to take responsibility until we realize what actually changed in our head, right? Was it when you were bullied as a kid? You know, was it your dad telling you something that you didn't like to hear? Was it somebody that you thought had your back, not having your back, right? Was it breaking up with that girl that you love? You know what I mean? It's one of those things where if you can't face yourself, if you can't make peace with the past and the things that you've done, and really make sure that those things do not define who you are, They're only experiences to be experienced, and then you let them go. That's going to be the hardest thing that we do as men. And that's also going to be the most important step that you're going to take in order to embody the man that you believe that you are. And because if you're not willing to do the hard things, which is the getting up early, getting to the gym, the having the hard conversation with your father, the setting your boundaries with your lover, your girlfriend, people at your job, your friends, whatever. If you're not willing to do any of those things, then it's going to be a long uphill battle. And it doesn't have to be hard. It doesn't have to be as hard as people think that it has to be in order to have, you know, that feeling of self-fulfillment, feeling of progress and growth. People can find me at Coach Me Clark, Instagram and TikTok, on the internet as well at CoachMeClark.com. Basically, yeah, I have one-on-one coaching, I have a group coaching setting as well. But I think that there's not a one-size-fits-all for this. I'm not for everybody, right? But the people that I'm here for, I'm really here for you. We're on this journey together, right? I'm not a perfect human being, but I've learned a lot. I've been in a lot of spaces. I've been in the self-development space. I've taken workshops of the classes, all of those things. I've lived my life as an embodied masculine man. And for a long time, people have been like, what is it that you have? What do you have, Andrew? I don't get it. What do you have? I want some of that. And that's really what started me on this journey. I've been mentoring guys for the last 10 years. You know, I'm 32 years old. I'm not super old. When it comes to fitness, when it comes to showing up, when it comes to interacting with women, all of those things, it's just stuff that the universe has blessed me with through my experiences to really kind of understand who I am and how I represent myself and masculine men when I'm in areas in space. And it's not that difficult, but we're here together and let's get to work, gentlemen.
There we go. Yes. And let's get to work. And I will throw all those links in the description box below so men can get to work. Don't allow these movies and these women to say that you can be weak and that you can be docile. Learn how to be the true natured masculine man that you should be. I want to thank you so much, Andrew, for coming on, spending a little bit of time with us today and talking about the work that you do. All right, everyone, and thank you so much for watching that interview with Andrew Cope and myself. Masculinity is under attack. From our Jordan Petersons to our Andrew Tates, those people are extremely masculine, right? You do have to understand that masculine has different natures. You can be a masculine man who's a family man who, you know, has a bunch of girls as your offspring, and you can still be a masculine man. For some people, they're going to struggle in the sense of, I'm trying to be the most masculine man. So what does that mean? Do I have to like drive fast cars and motorcycles and get in fights and beat people up and have these big muscles? It depends. It depends on what your image of masculinity is, because you do need fitness as a man. You do need presence as a man, as we said. But when it comes to the fine details, like being a family man, being a soldier or something like that, like there's different types of masculinity there too. Being a bodybuilder, masculine there too. Being a businessman, masculine nature there too. Depending on what type of masculine you envision for yourself is going to determine the path that you take. So each of those roles are going to require a different type of mindset, but the mindset is still a blanket of what everything, what is masculine. So your masculine nature of making sure that everything is tight and fit and you are in control. And I'm not saying that you have to be in control of everything in your life, but what I am saying is that it is difficult for men, especially today, to be who they truly are because they're going to be ridiculed. To that, I say, F it. People are not going to like you. People are going to hate you. People are going to look at you and they're going to say things. I said something in the episode, and this is something I hold true today, because our world today is incorrect, is full of misinformation because the facts are labeled as misinformation. So men should be men. Men should be masculine. Men should be dangerous, but men should understand that they can be in control of that. So learning how we can make progress in our masculinity is going to be essential. We have to make sure each and every day that we're pushing ourselves to be who we are supposed to be. We're not talking about being docile. We're not talking about being complacent. We're talking about being true to our nature. And for many people, it's going to be something that they don't want to hear. They don't want to know. They don't want to see. So we do have to shine. And if we hurt some people's feelings, oh well. If we make people uncomfortable, oh well. Because as a man, as a masculine man, you should be feared in a sense, right? There's an aspect of fear and respect. Men should always be respected. Men typically always have that level of respect for each other. As I was saying in the interview, how you can make contact with a guy and we might look at each other and whatever. That's respect, because I'm not going to just be like, hey, you know, what's your problem? Things like that, because there is that chance of an altercation that can be deadly. So we do understand that nature of men, where we're not trying to run away from who we are. We are very comfortable in who we are. And as a masculine man, you should look for a feminine nature woman. I talk about this all the time. Relationships work best with the different dynamics. Feminine nature and masculine nature work. It doesn't matter if the woman wants to be masculine and the guy wants to be feminine, or if the guy wants to be masculine and the woman has to be feminine. But what we need to understand is that men need to learn how to be masculine, how to be natured in a sense of, I am a samurai, I have a sword. And just because I have a sword, it doesn't mean I'm a danger to society. I am very aware of my skills in swordsplay, and I'm very aware and cognizant of when to draw and unsheath my sword. Masculinity is the same thing. When do you have to be a true natured masculine male? All the time. Number one, you're always a samurai. But when do you draw the sword? When do you show your fangs? When do you clench your fist and say to the world that I'm going to show you just how dangerous I can be? And men all have that monster, that demon within them that they can build up, that they can feed, and that they can show the world, because that is going to be your greatest ally in life, that true nature masculine male. It's not about emotional intelligence. It's about the understanding of your power. You can destroy the world or you can help build it up, because at the end of the day, who builds the world is men. My name is Michael Reardon. I'm a mindset coach. If you have any questions, you can email me coachinginsession@gmail.com. And I'll see everyone on the next episode of Coaching in Session. Until then, everyone, take care.